A PDF of additional materials accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Survival Math, Notes on an All-American Family by Mitchell S. Jackson. Read by the author.
For justice, for Jaden. In memory of Aaron Jojo Cowan. That man who was forced each day to snatch his manhood, his identity, out of the fire of human cruelty that rages to destroy it knows, if he survives this effort, and even if he does not survive it, something about himself and human life that no school on earth, and indeed no church, can teach. James Baldwin. And there are no new pains. Audre Lorde. Author's note. We are survivors, descendants of the Africans who endured the wretched march to the west coast of their continent, brutal confinement, a cruel transatlantic passage, and reached alive, somehow alive, the shores of a new world. Among the future generations of those captured humans are the men on this book cover, all of whom are my family members, each of whom I photographed and asked the same question: what's the toughest thing you've survived? I wrote their responses as second-person narratives and featured them along with their portraits. To grant a measure of anonymity, I forsook noting which story belongs to which man. The stories are part of the survival files, which are presented in the interstices of the parts in this audiobook. The narratives of the men in my family are separate from the narratives in the essays, but they are one with the story of Black Americans. We are all American, which is to say, our stories of survival are inseparable from the ever-fraught history of America. Prologue. Dear Marcus, ain't no way you can know this, but you were the first of us to set foot on the land that became the state where I was born, Oregon. And now here we are, strangers but not estranged, more like kindred, more like forever more tethered to terra firma by a death date and birth date. Yours, August 16th, 1788. Mine, August 16th, 1975. Here I am centuries after your death, wanting to share with you what has become of the place where you gasped your last breath and I gloried my first. There's much I don't know about your living and breathing in Cape Verde, so I've envisioned what it was like, have pictured you hanging near the ports, burnished, famished, bleary-eyed, proclaiming to anybody with ears that you'd board a ship bound for the New World and change forevermore your fortune. Then Captain Robert Gray and his crew docked their sloop for a little R&R and refitting. The way I picture it, Gray trekked inland and high-sided about how historic his voyage would be, about how he'd captain his Lady Washington around Cape Horn and through the Drake Passage to America's west coast to trade trinkets for furs and sail on to China, about how he was looking to add a new member to his small crew. As I imagine it, his notice sounded to you like the ocean looked in your dreams. So, you fat-mouthed to Gray and crew how much you knew about seafaring, how quick you could learn what you didn't know. Big upped how good you were with your hands, how able a swimmer you were, the super thew in your thin arms and legs, declared if there was a challenge to be met, you'd meet it. So help you God. Whatever your pitch, sure enough, you were soon aboard the ship and sailing around the horn for this new world. What were those days like? Did you expect to watch the sunset over the horizon? To witness a full moon in a sky sprint with stars? To hear the music of the sails catching the wind? But instead sorrowed over gales bashing the yards, a tempest tossing the ship on her broadside, Gray yelling, "All hands on deck!" Your shipmate Haswell, did y'all call him Robbie? Logged in his journal details of your first day in this place we share. Your last day on Earth. He wrote that the ship landed at Tillamook Bay, and he and some of the crew had a meal with the natives while the rest of you were out cutting grass for the livestock. That you took a break, stabbed your cutlass in the sand, and when you turned your back, one of the natives snatched it and broke out. I imagine you dreaded. Were it me, I would have been spooked something serious. The prospect of Gray learning you'd lost your tool, of him losing faith in you, and that you wanted to avoid at grave cost the prospect of the crew teasing you something terrible about being green and or the haters among them dubbing you a dim-witted black boy for the rest of the voyage. Or maybe it was fear that the cost of the tool be subtracted from whatever pay Gray had offered if he pledged any recompense at all. As Haswell told it, there wasn't much time between you peeping your missing cutlass and catching the culprit. Per his pen, while he and some of the other crew raced to your aid, the natives instantly drenched their knives and spears with savage fury in you until you released the thief, staggered, and fell dead. Haswell admitted he and the others, punk shit perhaps, broke for the ship to avoid the same happening to them. Marcus, the second one of us. When I say us, whom do you take it to mean? On record to set foot in what became this place we share was a dude named York who traveled with the Lewis and Clark expedition. York is damn near mythic for his time as Clark's indispensable manservant slave. We, you and me, should feel proud of the tales of him whipsawing thick-ass logs at Camp Dubois, hefting supplies no one else could, flexing his superior skills at hunting buffalo, geese, brants, being chosen to share his big medicine with native women who believed him a dark-skinned and nappy-haired wonder. York helped the Corps map out part of the Oregon Trail in those pre-Civil War days when they called this place the Oregon Country. Oregon being a name anointed in 1822 by the Florida congressman who proposed a bill to incorporate the area as a territory. In the Oregon Country, owning slaves long-term was outlawed. However, the autonomous provisional government passing a lash law, ephemeral though it was, confirms those Oregon pioneers were still anti-us. Blacks in Oregon, be they free or slave, will be whipped twice a year until he or she shall quit the territory. Congress at last voted into existence the Oregon Territory in 1848 and elected a new provisional government, or rather, more men willing themselves white who believe with just the right statutes, one of which was our exclusion, this land could become their paradise. Marcus, had you lived long enough to instead immigrate to this paradisical place post the repeal of its initial exclusion law, you would have been subject to laws that forbade you voting or acquiring free land or an ordained coupling with any white soul. Who could and couldn't come, who could or couldn't stay, was tough, tough talk, though, praise, praise. It amounted to but one expulsion. That hapless victim was a fair-skinned man named Jacob Vanderpool. Picture Vanderpool dressed impeccable in a checkered vest and tailored trousers and bucked white shirt, with his silk tie bowed just so, him buzzing around his boarding house saloon restaurant when the sheriff showed up to arrest him because a local white business owner contended him in violation of the exclusion law. Picture Vanderpool's lawyer soon thereafter arguing the charge against his client was out and out unconstitutional. Picture the prosecutor calling witnesses, none of whom can say for fact when this not light-skinned enough man arrived in their midst. And the judge delivering his verdict. I, being satisfied that the same Jacob Vanderpool is a mulatto and that he is remaining in the territory of Oregon contrary to the statutes and laws of the territory, do therefore order that the said Jacob Vanderpool removed from said territory within 30 days from and upon the service of this order. The said order to be served by showing to the said Jacob Vanderpool this original and at the same time delivering to him a true copy of the same. Imagine that sheriff serving Vanderpool the verdict at his boarding house saloon restaurant the same day it was adjudged, and that judgment quavering in Vanderpool's hands as he read it again and again and worried over delivering the news to his workers and finding a state, a city, a people that would accept him. Imagine Vanderpool, a symbol for Oregon's colored folk for decades to come, packing all that he could over the next few days and striking off quiet and stealthy from a white man's land. 70 or so miles lie between the beach village where you drew your last breath in the curious city where I drew my first. A city birthed when men surnamed Lovejoy in Overton, fast friends canoeing the Willamette for Oregon City, docked near a well-known grove of trees called the Clearing. In my mind, the men hopped out, swanked inland, turned their heads to visors against a majestic sun, prospected as far as their cerulean or where they green eyes could see, and proclaim to their munificent God, this should be ours. In the next months, they cleared more land, built structures, laid out plans. Within a year, though, a flood hit and spooked Overton into selling his stake in the claim to a man surnamed Pettigrove. Per the lore, both Lovejoy and Pettigrove wanted to christen the settlement after the New England city they hailed from, and thrice flipped a copper penny that decided Portland it would be. Portland cityhood preceded Oregon statehood, which Congress granted on Valentine's Day in 1859. Should you
have lived? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.